Good evening. Afternoon. Welcome to the Doctor Who panel with Big Finish and 50 years of Doctor Who. Let's introduce our guest, Jason Haigh-Ellery, producer for Big Finish, Doctor Who audio dramas. The voice of the Daleks, Cyberman, Jadoo. Himself, Colin Baker.
Drive a lot in my job, going from one theatre to another and things like that. And I love sitting in my car, being transported, listening mainly to Big Finish Audios, because I make them, and then years later, I think, I never actually listened to that. And by that time, I'd forgotten the story. And I frequently arrived at places that I'm supposed to be, and then sat in the car park for half an hour, because I wanted to know how it ended. And the joy, for me, of audio drama is, first of all, I look exactly the same as I did in 1980. I know a lot of you are saying, well, you do look exactly the same. But there may be some of you who are saying that I've changed a bit, but on audio, I'm exactly the same. The heroine is the most beautiful woman you ever heard. The villains are the scariest you ever heard, because your own imagination joins in with the skill of the actors and the scriptwriters, and it's a shared experience. Unlike television, where you're spoon-fed, you know, what people look like, their idea of beauty, their idea of scary. With audio drama, we're all in it together. That's why I love it, and that's why I love doing it. And I can carry on doing it.
You haven't had a Big Finish.
Yeah, you must start. We have Tom Baker, Peter Davison, Colin Baker, Sylvester McCoy, and Paul McGann. Paul McGann's done loads of stories.
Tom Lou.
And we've got a question from the audience, perhaps. Who would like to ask a question?
Handily placed microphones.
Exactly there. Okay, Ross first, you.
Or Nick. Two quick questions.
Okay.
First, a while ago you had you were planning a Sylvester McCoy audio written by John Ashbender as a Western Dead Man's Hand, if I remember correctly. Is that never going to ever happen?
I don't think that's ever going to happen, no. Sorry about
and
that.
And the second question, yes. You also used to have writing contests and things like that. Do you have any of them ever coming up again?
Well, we've had two opportunities for people to submit script ideas and get a chance to write for Big Finish.
Pardon? Gina the Bread Lodge is one of them.
Yeah. I know. It's my job. the first one was done by my predecessor, Gary Russell, and he had an open script policy for about a year or something, and it nearly broke him. You know, the trouble is, you're so busy doing the job, producing and getting stuff going, that actually giving proper attention to the good work sent in by people, it became all-consuming for him. But I think some opportunities were obtained by some people. Then we did one where people only had a week to send in a one-page story idea for a 25-minute story. And again, my script editor, Alan Barnes, who's brilliant, it was his job to go through all these submissions, and we nearly broke him as well.
Now it's in about 700 submissions?
No, it's 1,200.
1,200,
yeah. In a week? Yeah, not to count all the ones that came afterwards. We had to guillotine. But some good writers came out of it, so we know we must do it. We can't just keep using the same pool of writers, no matter how brilliant they are, and they are brilliant. Obviously, I include myself in that. it's something we must do again, but we have to find a way of doing it, because there's no point getting someone to assess it who isn't the script editor or the producer, because they're the people who have to know whether it's good or not for their kind of Doctor Who. That's the other thing, you know. Everyone has a different idea of what Doctor Who is and what good Doctor Who is. While I'm, you know, executive producer of Big Finish, it has to sort of conform to my idea. Sounds horribly dictatorial, doesn't it? Anyway, thank you. I'll tell you what, before we have another question, the night at the end, we've got another video showing you in what formats it's available. Could we play the second video, please?
at this point, I should point out that when we said how many of you know Big Finish, there wasn't a huge number really in the room that know what Big Finish is. If we're in a British convention, I'd say probably 90%, maybe 95% of the people who were there would know who Big Finish was and had listened to our productions. And that's partially because there's a bigger history of radio drama in the UK. And it's been very easy for people to get involved. I mean, historically, I mean, we've had a number of very famous subscribers. Russell T. Davis was a subscriber.
That's how I got the job as voice of the Dalek.
Yeah, exactly. Audio was always seen as a proving ground for a number of productions before it went to television in the UK. And, for example, when Russell brought back the series, he came to us and said, I'd like these two stories, please, which were Spare Parts and Jubilee. And Jubilee, of course,
thank you,
there we go, brilliant script by Rob Sherman, which was originally with Colin's Doctor. And that was made into Dalek in the first series.
Mine was better. No, the story was better, I think. There you are.
And Spare Parts were made into Rise of the Cybermen and Age of Steel, is that correct?
Yeah.
In the second season. So there's been in the UK a big history of interaction between the audio adventures and the television series. And in fact, if you go and have a look at our wares, as it were, David Tennant did 16 productions. He did 16 productions.
I'm going to take David Tennant for that.
Well, DTX, as he's known, he did 16 productions for Big Finish before he went and did the television series. He actually was one of our leading actors in the series. It was quite funny, he came in through a friend of ours, Toby Longworth, who was working with at the RSC.
Yeah,
you see, Toby, brilliant performer. He said, I don't know what I can say here. Oh, I'm going to put my foot.
You've started now.
I'm going to start it. No, in this case, he came and did some minor roles for us. And quite embarrassingly, he said to me, he's very, very, he's a lovely guy, David, and he's very modest. And he said to me one day, he said, actually, while he was doing medicinal purposes with you, he said, oh, I'm at the National, do you want to come and see it? And I thought, oh, yeah, definitely, I'll come and see you. And I thought it was a supporting friend. And I went there with my then girlfriend and we watched the show. And I said, oh yeah, David's at the National, it's very exciting, okay, go see it. And he came out, we started talking, and about 5 minutes in, I thought, oh God, he's the lead. And I hadn't realised, and that's the sort of man he is. But he made us realise when he started working with Big Finish that he was so good, we better give him leads. So he became the lead in a series called Dalek Empire. Yes, Nick, do you want to talk? Sorry, I'll stop now.
I'm still struggling with the thought of Sylvester McCoy doing a Western. Did I really hear that?
No, I mean, the better one was that Sylvester McCoy came up with this brilliant idea to do a silent movie on audio.
Yes. What Sylvester McCoy should do.
When he came up with that idea and put it to me, I said, you do realise we're talking about 2 hours of a piano playing. Just put your CD on to. Yeah, it'd be brilliant. And maybe a bit of spoon playing, I don't know. You'd hear it, obviously.
I must remember, because we doctors habitually make derogatory remarks about each other. But I must remember that sometimes people take it a bit seriously. And just said, he's a very dear friend of mine.
He's a lovely guy, Sylvester McCoy. I just wanted to compliment the AV team. I've been to many, many events. I've never been to this event, and I have never had an event when I cue a video and it just happens on the screen. I love you guys. For
questions in a minute, but maybe we could play that last audio clip, which is an audio trailer for Light at the End. It gives you a clue of stuff that's going on in there, so if we can hear that clip. Let's, I don't know if the lights go out or not. Can't work it out.
Time travel, I should be used to it.
Come on, Kevin, you can't keep scoring guns if you're the one in the
They appear to have landed inside someone's garden shed.
Well, and sometimes I think you're probably the finest ship out of solar vortex.
Am I perhaps interrupting something deeply personal?
You are with the Time Lords.
Not humans, are they?
Not remotely, no.
It's all right here. I don't think she means us any harm.
Let's find somewhere safer.
Wait a minute, no, we can't!
What? Go above the doctor, or I will
make you. Nina, there's no need for that.
Blimey, what's going on?
Forgot about you, Ted.
Did you? Are we that forgettable?
What a resourceful young lady you are. Ace?
Thanks, but. Doctor?
I said something. Something is here with us. In the TARDIS.
It's like a ghost in the TARDIS.
This is a bad place, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
How many more of me have you captured?
What's going on?
What's going on? Oh, no.
Good grief. There appears to be some kind of warning.
Go on. Run, run, run.
Okay, let's have a question from them.
I was just wondering if any of you had any information on the 50th anniversary special that we premiered in November.
On television?
Oh, yes.
I was in it, but I'm sworn to secrecy.
I was not in it, and therefore I'm not sworn to secrecy. And I can safely assure you that having seen Peter and Sylvester and Paul very recently, none of them are in it either. For some reason they decided that their 50th celebrations would be better without doddering old doctors cluttering the place up. And to be honest, I can see why. Because if you have to write a story incorporating 2,371 doctors, the script takes a second place. Whereas if you've just got, as I understand it, the two most recent doctors, you're more likely to be able to construct a more cohesive and credible story. So I suspect it's going to be very, very good because they have a sense of occasion. But if you want to have a multi-doctor story, Big Finish is your answer.
My name is Rich. Thank you very much for being here and coming across the ocean to see us. I'm a big fan of what Big Finish has done to expand on the Doctor's characters, especially Mr. Baker's here, because I think you got shafted by the BBC. My big question is elements that have been developed for the new series still off limits to the Big Finish productions, or will we see like the Jadoon and other new things that have been created for the series?
Yeah, I mean, our license at the moment covers the classic series, as it were, and you never know what's going to happen in the future, but at the moment it's definitely the case that we're doing the classic series. Having said that, there's a huge, huge universe for us to play in within that. I'm sure at some time we would love to work with the Jadoon or, you know, I mean, for a start, I mean, he wants another pay packet, so. but yes, I mean, it's at the moment it's just the classic Doctors, and we're very happy with that.
There's no just about it, but yeah,
no.
We have done a co-production with Audio Go, who are the BBC's, who do that, you know, have the BBC audio catalogue. We did that thing called Destiny of the Doctor, which has been running throughout this year, and that was a co-production. So maybe stuff like that can happen in the future, because that incorporated new Doctor Who.
Yes.
Should we have another question? Because I'm aware that there's a big queue and not much time.
Good luck, by the way, with doing the Angels and the Silence on audio.
You can do anything on audio.
Look, it's moved. Don't blink. I wasn't blinking. How can you tell?
I can blink for the entire story.
Although you've worked out, haven't you, Colin?
Oh, do you know, this blink nonsense. If you have an inferior doctor, he's not going to be able to solve that one. But a superior doctor could tell you, all you have to do is change eyes, wink, don't blink. Well, see, the problem is, the series ended. I never regenerated. Did I?
No.
Did you see me regenerate?
No.
Therefore, I am still the doctor. Sylvester McCoy is an imposter. First of the subsidiary line, there, I am the doctor. Nice and funny! It is a revolution. You will have seating!
I do. How did you do that? Are they in the middle there?
Yes.
I'm
Haigh.
Oh.
Sorry, I'm in the middle. I'll come to you in a minute. Sorry.
The men in orange must be obeyed.
We're going there, right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The lovely Ace costume then. Over to you.
Could three people ask a question at once? Go on. Who's doing it? I said in the middle, let's just follow my big finger. Look, I'm the one on the stage. Who did it?
My name is Ellen. Big fan. Colin, I know you mentioned that you really, really enjoy listening to Big Finish audios, especially your own.
That's all I've heard.
I didn't mean to, you know. But I just wanted to know, which one is your personal favorite?
Oh boy, that's a hard one. Because every time I play one of them, I think, oh, that's my favorite! I've recently decided that the F word is not to be used, favorite. Do you know what I mean? Because favorite implies something about everything else. I don't have a favorite finger. I don't have a favorite leg. Or eye. Or daughter. Or four daughters. Favorite stories? Name one and I'll say, oh, that's my favorite. Name another one. So's that. I mean, there are ones that have pulled at my heartstrings. There are ones that have excited me. There are ones that have perplexed me. But to be honest, amongst equals, there are no favorites. And they're all equally good. I am amazed at the standard of scripts that appear through my, well, used to be through my letterbox. Now it's on my iPad. and I read them, and I think, another good, how do they keep coming up with them? But they do.
Colin is the only doctor to read off iPad.
What, in the studio?
For me, though,
I've got to say, the only time I ever cried doing an audio performance was actually your performance in Arrangements for War.
In a good one,
in a great
one, I liked.
Yes. Which is brilliant. If you haven't heard Arrangements for War, it is fantastic, but be prepared to cry at the end.
Okay, question that question.
Yes.
Yeah, yes, in that line.
Hello.
Hello. Pointing at you.
Okay. Yes, sorry, I'm
hello.
Hi.
Were you in that Dalek earlier?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I'm the regenerating doctor.
Oh, are you?
It's not one of the questions, it's just, for Nicholas, can you just do like the Cyberman voice or something, the voices you do?
Do something.
Come on, do something, Nick.
Dance, monkey, dance. Exterminate. Come on.
Was that the most sensible voice you ever came out
that you do?
I don't know what you mean.
Okay, let's, did you want to, Ace? Yes, come on.
say I just wanted to comment on what he said about people not here and not knowing a lot about big audio. I started Doctor Who in the 70s here in America, and I love classic Who and I love new Who, and I think that the audio is a brilliant way of introducing how amazing the classic Doctors were. And I think that TV is limited because the special effects that were on them are very hard to watch after you've seen the new one. So,
what do you mean?
I just think it's a great way to introduce you to a new generation. And I'm certainly going to show it to my son, and I just wanted to know that I love you.
Thank you very much.
Would you like to be our publicist?
It's over here,
the TARDIS. Alright, actually I'm the Cowardly Lion. The Doctor gave me my courage. So, alright, Colin, so obviously you have a strong fondness for what people keep calling classic Who. I'm not sure why it's any different than just Doctor Who. But I was wondering though, in the reboot, I'm assuming you've watched all of it, so if you could have been in one episode of the reboot, since the time it started again in 2005, what episode would that be? I know it doesn't have to be your favorite, it could just be any episode.
Yeah, in order to say one line, which I think is a line that sums up Doctor Who, that would be the Doctor dances when he says, "Everybody lives." Incredible drama where everybody lives all the time, but that is what the Doctor is about, and in that story he achieved it. And he had the best costume, the one I wanted. I wanted that.
Next question. In the middle.
Hi, my name's Aaron.
Hello.
Nick, I was wondering how you got your job as the aliens, the voice of the aliens?
Well, it was basically because I was doing the voices for Big Finish, the Dalek voices, which I think I said yesterday, I apologise if you've heard this before, I did say to the then producer, Gary Russell, oh, could I do the Dalek voices for our audios, or do you want to see a grown man cry? So he gave me the job, and I did that, and Russell T. Davis, you know, who brought the TV series back, listens to our CDs, and when he was looking to bring someone in to do the Dalek voice, he said, I want that guy. Also because I've written a very sad article in Doctor Who magazine about how technically the Dalek voice was done and all that kind of stuff. So he thought, that guy is the solution for it. So that's how I got the job. It was brilliant. No audition necessary.
Well,
oh yeah, that was a bizarre thing, because I'd done the Daleks, they just assumed I'd do the Cybermen, so everyone on the show assumed I'd do it, but the people who phoned up your agent to book you for the job, they didn't know about it. And so I had David Tennant texting me saying, well, we're filming it now, why aren't you here? Russell T. Davis doing Cyberman impersonations to me down the phone. And they said, well, I'll see you later this week, and I said, well, I presume so. With that slightly petulant quality in my voice. He said, what do you mean you presume so? And I said, well, nobody's booked me for this job. He said, right, I'm going to kick some ass. I went down, and a couple of minutes later, my agent phoned me. He said, what have you done? This huge booking had come through. And they booked me for every single Cyberman scene. And then I escaped your attention that the Cybermen didn't speak in every scene. So they booked me to be there to go. Another question there?
Okay, hi. So I'm probably going to phrase this poorly because I'm not really good with words.
Oh no.
I know.
He's a writer. He's a writer.
Yeah. Don't worry, we'll edit it. It'll be fine in post production.
Yeah. Hopefully. Okay, anyway. So this is for Colin Baker. Yes. Main Street. Anyway. So. I told you I'm bad with words. So you were part of the original series. What's it like watching the new series? Like, what's it like seeing the new doctors personified compared to your doctor and what you worked on?
It's weird. And I think every doctor that I've spoken to have trouble watching the Doctor immediately after them. Peter didn't watch me, I didn't watch Sylvester, because there are two possibilities. Either he would be brilliant, which I'm sure he is, which would hack me off, or he'd be awful, which would hack me off even more. So I thought it was safer not to... excuse me. I thought it was safer not to watch, so I wouldn't have to comment. So I still haven't seen any of Sylvester's. But then he was off the screen for 11 years, and I watched it come back, and it was fantastic, actually. I thought it came back superbly. As somebody pointed out over there, the intervening 11 years introduced some special effects capability, which was undreamed of in my day, when I used to have to hold the wall up. Which happened on one occasion. We couldn't complete the scene because if I'd gone away, as I should have done, the wall would have fallen down. That apparently doesn't happen now.
I've broken some switches on the TARDIS console. Not that I'm in those scenes, I just go in there and fiddle around with it. I've fiddled with all the new TARDIS consoles. It's a sort of rite of passage there. Is this the new set? Right, here we go.
But I have loved it. I have a theory that any good actor could play the Doctor. Some for 5 minutes, some for 7 years. But I think most actors have a valid right to play the Doctor if they're cast. And all you have to do is look back at the last 11. They're all different, and they're all, well, I modestly forbid, but to the ones I've watched, they're all fantastic. So I've no reason to expect that ever to change. And the new one that's been announced, Peter Capaldi. I mean, he's brilliant, but he's a grown-up as well. He's got 12 years old. But we want the girls to keep watching. So maybe Tennant might appear in one, I never know.
Are you saying that David Tennant is a penguin?
No, I'm saying very slim and good looking.
Okay, question there, the Union Jack.
The Union Jack, yeah, she's been waiting.
Hi, I'm Megan. Hi.
Hi.
This is for Nick. I just want to let you know, I think you're great with your voices, you're always funny. And I've seen you in behind the scenes footage and in interviews and on the Lucas Link, and you can tell that you and
Tiger Woods. Yeah, he knows that now.
You can tell that you enjoy doing his voices. Mm. Is there a particular episode that you enjoy doing the voices more?
Oh, well, I mean, I don't think anything beats the thrill of doing it for the first time. Of, you know, going to Cardiff and there was on set, and Barnaby Edwards, who was in the Dalek, and I were kind of treated like demigods, you know, which is, you know, you can't help it. If anyone, you know, throws paraffin on your ego and sets it alight, you know, it's fantastic. So that was a huge thrill, and it was new stuff, and there were loads of frustrations into it, because there were loads of technical difficulties. That was a thrill.
What was the reading like, first time?
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, you know, the director phoned me and said, could you bring your that does the voice along to the read-through? So I brought the ring modulator and the speaker and everything and the microphone. So I arrived at the read-through and was saying hello to the other actors, and I started to get all this equipment out, plugging it into the mains power supply and everything, and these actors were looking at me in a very strange way, and I said, have you brought yours? Some of them looked at me and said, oh my God, I'm supposed to bring one of them. Anyway, Billy Piper and Christopher Eccleston were busy. Busy filming scenes. They got the timing of Doctor Who wrong in the first series. They kept editing the scripts of the episodes down really tightly, and then they filmed them and discovered they were 10 minutes under. So they were busy shooting stuff to put back in, you know, so they were delayed. And it was a real learning process. It was the first time they'd made anything like this at Deep Sea Wales. Anyway, so we just got to the point where we'd assigned two of the very small part actors to read in for the Doctor and Rose. And we were all thinking, oh, we're not going to have the Doctor and Rose. Yeah, they agree, I'm sure they do a good job. And we literally just started reading it, and suddenly the double doors of the room burst open, and Millie Piper and Chris Eccleston just burst in, like, as you'd see them later, the Doctor and Rose. Of course, I've not seen them before, you know, and ran in, and they were just came in and sat down and went, all right, quick, let's do the read-through. So they haven't had a chance to really clock who I was. So when it came to the first Dalek scene, and I switched it on and just did sort of the noise, you know, Chris Eccleston went, hey. And everyone was just applauding and screaming and shouting. It was, you know, a wonderful thing. And interestingly, though, because it's a very British thing, there was a girl in the cast who had not been brought up in Britain, and she had never seen Doctor Who before. She knew nothing about it. And, you know, as you do, if people are screaming and shouting, you kind of look around to see if there's anyone who isn't. That's how kind of went out. And in the middle of all, she was just sitting there going... She didn't know what a Dalek was. She had no idea. And it's interesting, isn't it? Everyone else was going wild. And actually on set, you'll know which character she was now. There's a bit when Van Staten, Dalek is advancing on him, and she's in the background looking. On the first take, she was just looking, and the director, Joe Hearn, said, "Don't you think you look a bit scared?" And she looked at the Dalek and said, "What of that?" It's been killing people! Oh, yeah, got it. Another question, who should I go for? You.
Hi. Well, this kind of goes out to everyone. Up there. It'd be a bit hard to have everyone answer the question.
Take off some wine.
Who is all of your favorite doctors, Colin, besides yourself?
The F word.
It's the F word. I always used to say Patrick Trapp, because for me, because he did the thing that you might be sitting here looking at this empty table thinking, why are we here? If Patrick Troughton hadn't done the first regeneration so magnificently. Because I don't know who had the idea, but somebody thought, oh, Bill Hartnell's not doing it anymore. Oh well, hang on. We could just recast and regenerate. That's the way to do it. And that person should have a huge memorial to them, I guess. They're probably not around anymore. Because then they cast Patrick Troughton to do it, who turned out to be a genius and created something different and exciting and charming. And without him, there wouldn't be 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So good old Pat for that reason.
Because there's been so much publicity about it, we've now got Web of Fear and Enemy of the World back.
Yeah.
Well, I would urge you to go out there and watch it. I know you downloaded it at 5 o'clock in the morning.
I did.
That's what you wanted to see.
And as I'm publicly ashamed of myself, that I watched Web of Fear, and it was very early in the morning, so I then had to go and have a shower to, you know, face the world. And I actually sobbed like a child in the shower with the emotional impact of seeing that again. Because I remember seeing it the first time. It was just amazing. You've got to go on iTunes and buy it. I agree with Colin that Patrick Troughton is my favourite Doctor, because it's a sort of slight twist on what you said, because he defined the Doctor as he is now. He defined him as the eccentric character who goes around doing good. And that's partly the writers at that time as well, because before that, the Doctor was kind of a grumpy old so-and-so who accidentally got involved in stuff, and his main motivation was to get out of there as soon as possible. Patrick Troughton was very, especially you'll see in The Enemy of the World, that entire story is about him trying to work out whether the double of him, Salamander, is in fact bad. He's got people telling him he's a bad, he's a despot, he's going to take over the world. And the Doctor keeps saying, but is he bad? I've only got your word for it. I must find out if he's bad before I act against him. Because William Hartnell would have been in the TARDIS and off. See the next exciting plan. And I think that, you know, and I've grown to love, I love all the Doctors. And especially I love all the ones I work with at Big Finish. You know, I knew Colin pretty well beforehand, but the others I didn't know so well. And I've grown to like them all in different ways. And in some ways I feel that I love their performances more when they're a little bit like Patrick Troughton. And I think that's the thing, that all the Doctors are a little bit like Patrick Troughton because of the way he defined it.
So he was the original Madman in the box?
Yeah, I think so.
after that, we'll go to another question, which presumably will be over there. There we go.
Hi, I'm Justin from San Aaron. What's up?
Hello.
Hello.
I recognise your face.
Thank you.
Your face or your fez?
That was...
Oh, I say...
I ruined it, man.
Edit that out.
This is a question that, like, any of you can answer. Peter Capaldi. He's been in 2 episodes, I believe, of one he was in Torchwood, and another one he was in Ancient Rome. How's that going to play out, being that he's the new Doctor?
Well, ask that about Max.
He's an actor. The actor playing another part. And I was in Doctor Who in Peter Davis.
Woo!
Excellent. As a result of which, John Nathan Turner, in his infinite wisdom and great common sense, asked me to play the part. You just have to accept that actors appear in different things, even in the Doctor Who universe. And there are many actors who play more than one part. So, it's a pure coincidence, I think, that only twice the actor's been cast to be in the series before. Because the series had been on 50 years, you'd be running out of actors who could play it. If you restricted it only to people who've never been in the programme.
Well, I mean, both Nick and I... Have you worked with Peter Capaldi?
No.
Both Nick and I have worked with him. Nick, obviously, on Torchwood. I produced a play in West End called Lady Killers, which he played the lead in. And I'm sure it's okay for me to say that on the opening night, I went into his dressing room and all around his room, I'd heard he was a bit of a Doctor Who fan. And when people say, oh, he's a bit of a Doctor Who fan, you think, oh, he likes Doctor Who. You don't think he's a big fan. But when I went in there, all across his shelves in his dressing room were Cybermen, TARDISes and Daleks, which all his friends had bought him for opening night presents.
Oh, wow!
So he knew who Big Finish was.
Oh, well, when I met him on the set of Torchwood, you know, he's an actor I've admired for many years. And by the way, there was a producer I knew back in the 90s. Actually, his name does slip my mind, but it's when a lot of people were thinking of putting bids in with the BBC about Doctor Who, and his big plan back in the 90s was to have Peter Capaldi as the Doctor. And I remember thinking, well, that's a good idea. Mind you, he's a bit young, I thought. Things have changed. But when I saw Peter on set, and I kind of started to walk over to him to sort of say, hi, I'm Nick, it's just lovely to, you know, work with you. He turned around, he saw me halfway across the room and stopped me dead, and he said, he saw my hand outstretched to shake his, and he said, you've no need to introduce yourself to me, Briggs. Oh my God, it's the voice of the dark. He seemed remarkably enthusiastic to meet me, which was, you know, it's lovely when someone who's famous does that to you. And I saw him the other day, actually. He was in for makeup and costume tests. I'd probably be fired for telling you that. I was delighted to see. Again, he stopped someone introducing to me because he said that we know each other. So I'm really looking forward to whenever it might happen of working with him on the show. I think it's going to be fantastic. I mean, I've had a blast with Matt. Matt's such a lovely guy.
The interesting thing about Matt Smith, of course, is the fact that we did actually consider him for a role in Big Finish.
There was a character, a companion from one of the Doctor Who books called Fitz. And we did a story called Company of Friends where the Eighth Doctor appeared with several of the... He appeared with Mary Shelley and Bernice Summerfield and Izzy from the comic strip and Fitz. And one of the people we considered for the part was Matt Smith.
And why didn't we employ him?
We didn't ask his agent, but he was on the list, and I said, oh, I know, I've seen him, he's really good. I said, he's far too young for the part, though.
Or the companion.
The companion. Little did I know. I mean, you know, he has this fantastic ancient quality about him. I just want to say, we could go on forever, but you will have to stop this. But anyway, next question.
Okay, you mentioned the comic strip. So my question is, how did you get to be the Doctor in the comic strip small period of time? And I apologize for anyone who has not read the story, spoilers, but...
well, I was, was in two of the comic strips, actually, in Doctor Who magazine. One of them, and it was because I, you know, Gary Russell, the first producer of Big Finish, and I had worked together for many years when we wanted to do Doctor Who for fun. We did audio plays, and this is the whole thing that Big Finish was born out of, where I was playing the Doctor. And it was done on audio, but I had a costume and everything. And, you know, I was only in the early 20s. And I can barely remember it. And so Gary, when he was editor of Doctor Who magazine, thought, there was a story where there was meant to be a sort of indeterminate future Doctor. And he thought, wouldn't it be fun if it was Nick? So he gave several photographs of me in costume, because we did publicity photographs for me for fanzines and things. I was getting sadder by the moment. And the artist put me in that one. But then much, much later, what was the story called?
Wormwood!
Yeah.
Wormwood.
I'm sorry. Hearing problem.
I cannot hear my ears.
Yes, that was Gary Gillett's idea. He was the editor then, I think. And he came round to my flat and he said, we need to take some pictures of you, but we need to make it look like you're leaning on the TARDIS console. And so I had an old Ford Sierra, and we're out in the car park, and I'm like, I'm leaning on the hatchback of my Ford Sierra, pretending it was the TARDIS console. I said, I could just imagine, you know, someone would see this, and it would be in the local newspaper, you know, man and his Ford Sierra thinks he's Doctor Who. So yeah, it was because they knew me, and they thought it would be a fun in-joke, really. But I did experience a tiny bit of pretend fame at that point. Because in London, there's a place called the Fitzroy Tavern, which every first Thursday of the month, Doctor Who fans spontaneously gather there. And I used to go there, being a Doctor Who fan, the Thursday after that magazine first came out, I went to go in there, and a friend of mine said, you don't want to go in there. Because people were either going to mock me or tear me to pieces. Because some people were like, how dare you replace the Eighth Doctor? You know? So it was an interesting time. That's how it came about. They knew me and they thought it would be funny. I worked at the Sci-Fi Channel at the time and they thought it was hilarious. I was with the, I was the head of marketing and PR manager.
You were obviously brilliant.
Wanted to get out of there. And the head of the vice president of marketing put photocopies of the strip all over everyone's desks. And I think in the story he said, would you like a cup of tea or something? And everyone said that to me that day. It was hilarious. Thank you.
Where are we going next? Is it over there?
I quite like the Dalek with the three bubbles. We'll come back to you in a moment. The Dalek, it's Dalek prejudice. That's a Dalek you haven't met so far.
Over there, that's the one, we're having that one.
Hi, my mom started watching Doctor Who as a kid and got me into Doctor Who, so that's something that we share together. So it's really special talking to my doctor. You're my fearless doctor, but who is the scariest foe for you?
The scariest foe?
Mm-hmm.
What, from my time or altogether?
Altogether, no matter what.
Michael Gray!
The silence does something to me. The idea that you can meet something that makes you forget the fact that you've met them, that's a very powerful weapon. In terms of what I would hate to have to deal with would be that. Something that affects your mind in that way.
But you can take them anyway.
The angels are easy, as I told you.
I'm not quite sure what the silence did that was bad for them.
What did they do? I can't remember quite my memory.
Hi, my name's Elizabeth. I just want to thank you guys for coming out here tonight. My question is for Colin. Altogether, what was your most memorable moment from filming on Doctor Who?
My most memorable moment? I suppose the most memorable moment was when I was filming Mark of the Rani. And by that time, I'd been playing the Doctor a little while and I felt pretty good about it. And we had to go do some pickup shots in some woods outside London. And there were shots that we needed to pick up in bright sunlight, and other shots that we needed to pick up in cloudy. And so we were running from one location to the other as the weather changed. And it was a scene, if you remember, when the Luddites with the red spots on their foreheads were carrying me strapped to a pole. Obviously, they put me in a harness, but I was actually tied to a pole, being carried along, and the weather changed. So I was unceremoniously dumped on the ground, and the entire crew disappeared over the hilltop to another location. As I was saying, yeah, good joke, can you untie, and they went. I was literally, I was only 100 yards away, but they couldn't see each other. So I was left in the middle of some woods, tied to a pole, and a couple came along with a dog. They came up and started sniffing me, and I said, don't you dare. And a couple looked at me and I said, hello, you might, and as I was saying, you might be wondering, they legged it. I rushed forward, grabbed their dog, and ran from the woods, presumably to report that some strange pervert was tied to a pole in the woods. That's the glamour of showbiz.
Speaking of the glamour of showbiz, Colin, I mean, was there an instant reaction when you were named as Doctor Who on television? Did it happen instantaneously that everyone went, oh my God, it's the Doctor?
Because I remember they told me they wanted to play the part, but asked me to be quiet about it and not tell anyone. I hadn't actually even told my agent, which was an odd thing to do, but my wife knew, and that was about it. And then I got a phone call on a Friday afternoon from John Nathan Turner saying, there's been a leak, get yourself into London. So I came to London fast to do a photo call with Nicola Bryant in a little garden somewhere off Oxford Street. And I've never seen so many photographers before or since, because the new Doctor thing is very potent in terms of press. And it went crazy. I went to a convention in Miami the following weekend. I hadn't seen the script, I hadn't done anything. And I was mobbed by hundreds of people simply because I'd been appointed as the new Doctor. It was well weird.
One more question and then we're done. Okay, make it a good one.
I'm Ava, and I was wondering, who's your, well, not favorite, but, like, out of the companions, which one do you prefer the most?
Which one do you prefer the most, Nick?
Oh, I don't know. I don't do favorites either. Goodness me. I was rather fond of Billy Piper.
I was waiting for the Nicola Bryant, you know what I mean? Nicola was my first companion, and I had two. I had Nicola and Mel, Harry and Mel. Through circumstances, I've kept much more in touch with Nicola, and she put up with quite a lot in the early days, as my doctor was discovering who he was, both on and off screen. And I am very fond of Perpetually Brown. And many men in this room will agree with me.
Hear, hear!
Well, that's it from us. I just want to thank you all for being here. Thank you. And we are at stand 31, row 3100 there. And don't forget, subscribers get more at bigfinish.com.